Good morning, everybody. Pleasure to be here, and thank you, Tove, for the opportunity. From the outset, if you don't mind me just checking, how many of you have been through this presentation before? Because this is, I don't know if how we do a poll.
You can just give us a thumbs up with your reactions at the bottom of the screen.
Where do I find that? And while I'm asking that, are there any specific requests that people would like me to cover? Because I mean, it's a broad presentation, so you know, there's many aspects that I could focus on. Just let me know. Okay, so there's a couple of you that have, I can see. Sorry, I'm just seeing all the answers coming in. What I'm asking for those who've just joined is how many of you have seen this presentation before? Andrew Stockton, remember the Wanderers, those days?
Oh yeah, it was cool back then. COVID. Pre-COVID.
Pre-COVID and post-COVID. Yeah, maybe I should clarify. Those of you who have seen this presentation pre-COVID and post-COVID. Okay. So I think most people it's their first time. Okay, next question is, I have a question for all of you as brokers, because I'm new to, well, relatively new to insurance. I've been in the environmental risk game for 25, 30 years. And I sold my risk consultancy into Marsh in 2006. And we were global practice leaders within Marsh for environmental risk. It was appropriately acronymed as MES, M-E-S, Marsh Environmental Services. And that was probably well ahead of you know, the current need for environmental issues has been driven by climate change. So it was very much ahead of its time. But now being on the underwriting side, as opposed to the risk side, one of the questions that I have to you as the broking community and helping me to frame this presentation is, what do you need to know to better sell this to your clients? Because I do this presentation to 700, 800 brokers a year, and everybody loves the presentation, and I'm sure you'll love it now, but I get very little follow-up. And I know it's difficult times, you know, we're coming out of COVID, et cetera, and the economy's tough. But I'm really relying on you to guide me as to what it is that you specifically need. So if you've got any specific requests or guidance notes as to what I can stress or comment on, to Fiona Thompson's point is, you know, please guide me with your comments and questions, and please don't wait until the end for that. Tove, please interrupt me if there's some good comments or questions that come up. But what we're introducing here is, and specifically on the gradual pollution side, is a relatively new product. And I'll take you back to when I was at Marsh as a sort of a contextual orientation as to where I'm coming from. In that it's, at the time we did the delisting of EnviroServe. So if you may recall, EnviroServe, the largest hazardous waste management company in South Africa, was actually listed on the JSE. And then APSA Capital Private Equity bought into it, and they asked us to do the DD, and I was project director on that due diligence. And at the end of the DD, all the banks came to me and said, all right, how do we underwrite the long tail liability, the existing known gradual pollution? There we are. There's the questions. That's brilliant. That's really helpful. Wow, look at that. Okay. That is very cool, Tove. Like doing a snap poll.
Yeah. Glad to help, James.
That is awesome. Sorry, that is fantastic. This is like watching the US elections, you know? This would be like, you know, Wisconsin before your eyes. Anyway, so 78% of you haven't attended. Those of you that have, hopefully you need a refresher or you benefit from it. But again, please shout your questions as early as you can, what you'd like me to focus on. But coming back to this idea, in 2009, we did the delisting of EnviroServe. The banks came to me and asked me to place the long tail liability, and there was no capacity, there was no local products. And I had to get Ace, Chubb, AIG, sounded like a shopping trip, London, Paris, New York. And nobody wanted to underwrite the existing known conditions. And they all quoted on the risk, excluding the gradual pollution. Obviously, times have changed, but it was then that I saw the need for this product within the market. And it's taken me the better part of 8 years to get this to where it is. It's still a relatively new product, this gradual pollution. We'll talk about the trucking product too. We'll talk about some of our other products that you might not be aware of. But I appreciate that this is a technically complicated product. Somebody had their mic off, mic on. Looking for your guidance, basically, I think is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so moving on, why the need? Well, my personal bugbear as an environmental risk specialist is this phrase in GL policies called sudden and accidental. And I have this, debate / argument with our own GL team internally at I2. And I mean, I2's, the majority of our book at I2 is on our GL policy. So it's a bit of a sort of an internal, shall I say, a point of contention. Sorry, somebody's microphone keeps on coming on. I'm trying to remove it from our GL policy schedules. But the guys at GL are saying, well, if we remove it, then we're uncompetitive relative to all the other underwriters in terms of GL policies. So I wanted to spend a few minutes repeating and reinforcing why I think that GL policies are, the wrong place to have a sudden and accidental pollution cover. And that a speciality pollution cover is required. So as a snap poll, if I could put up the next poll, Tove, I don't know if you can do this. How many of you on this call have had a valid claim for pollution under a GL policy? If we could just do a quick snap poll on that one. Tove, is that okay?
I'll put it up now.
Thank you.
You can carry on. Just repeat the question, James, please.
How many of the brokers on this call have had a valid claim for pollution cleanup under a GL policy? In other words, where they haven't had a specific EIL policy, it's under the GL sudden and accidental pollution clause. And I ask this question at every training that I give. Normally I do a poll by people putting up hands, but this is super effective as well. So what I'll do is, while I'm waiting for those results to come out, I'll talk about the word sudden and accidental. So, any takers on what the word sudden means? How do we define sudden? Legally, is anyone aware of any case law in this regard? And for that matter, accidental. Unexpected, unforeseen. Unexpected, unforeseen. But cancer is unforeseen. Not over a period of time. Thanks, Dudu. But what's a period of time? Define a period of time. I mean, time periods run from, billions of light years to, that's distance. decades to second. Somebody's unmuted. I'll mute them if they, without warning, could not be predicted. Okay, but that's risk, right? Unintentional, unexpected. Yeah. I'm looking more for a definition around sudden timing. Somebody said a period of time. I think by the lack of clarity around the answer around sudden, I think we can agree that, that there's some confusion around that. The closest we have in case law in South Africa is a general machinery breakdown claim that's specified. It literally has to be in a very short space of time. So MGR is said, I can't see, maybe it's Krobler, said done quickly. Yeah, quickly is the word. A couple of seconds, minutes max. Very seldom an hour, definitely not longer than an hour. So in a very short space of time, okay? And then accidental, the most common response I've seen here in the comments questions is unexpected. Claire Barnes, done quickly and unexpectedly or without warning. Yeah, so defining quickly, narrowing that down literally means, you know, an hour or less. I've never seen a sudden and accidental claim lasting longer than a couple of hours. You know, maybe a fire burns for a couple of hours, but that's quite unusual, right? You know, certainly the bulk of the damage is done very quickly. So the term accidental, you generally got right, unexpected, but unplanned, unscheduled. Yes, there, CJ Dunn, thank you, unplanned. So not part of your normal business. And risk is part of a normal business. So it's risks that nobody really foresaw, so unforeseen, you're correct. Which means that there is no adequate prevention in place. It's the probability was so low that it was deemed unnecessary to put in place additional mitigation measures, right? And if you combine those two terms together, very short space of time and unplanned, unscheduled, it places on the claimant, right, on the first party insured, significant onus to be able to locate with a high degree of accuracy the time, place, and circumstance. In other words, you should be able to very accurately denote exactly what happened, when, where, and what. And unless one can accurately ascertain those three points, it's very difficult to prove that this was not a gradual pollution incident and has been occurring over some time. So typically, those types of sudden and accidental events tend to be very dramatic. An explosion, a fire, a sinkhole, a rupture, a fire. I mean, I think we get the picture. And then it's pretty obvious to everybody what happened. Did you hear that? Did you see the smoke? Did you see the fallen tank? Right? I'm looking at the poll here. The numbers are increasing. So far we've got less than 5%. Only 5 people have had successful claims out of 143 respondents. 96% said that they haven't seen a successful claim under this. And if you combine these two elements, very often we've seen that attempted pollution claims under the GL policy, if they're not very specifically identified, time, place, and circumstance, can be easily repudiated by the underwriter, right? And it's in the public domain, so I can talk about it, but coming back to EnviroServe, at their Shongweni facility in Durban, just outside Durban, they had a pollution claim whereby several of the neighbors around their landfill in Chongqing that disposes of hazardous waste, that they claimed for, you know, loss of value and property, for health effects, for nuisance effects, given the odor coming out of the landfills. And EnviroServe responded by saying, well, it was due to a change in the regulations in 2015 that we responded to that gave rise to a different profile of gases and vapors coming out of the landfill. And their insurer, SHA, repudiated the claim, claiming that it was that was a gradual pollution claim. And they were only covered under the GL policy. And, you know, 35 million rand on legal defense costs. They had their permit withdrawn for 2 years, suffered an estimated 300 million rand in business interruption costs because they had to retransport the waste from Durban all the way up to Springs to dispose of it responsibly at the closest hazardous waste landfill. And significant losses to the business for trying to claim under their GL policy. And their argument was, you know, with all due respect to their lawyers at the time, they were trying to claim that the change in legislation was sudden and accidental, and hence the policy should have been respected. And, you know, if we had been the underwriter at the time, we would have repudiated it too and agreed with SHA. And, you know, it's this kind of misapplication of this particular clause that I think creates a lot of misunderstanding in the market, that clients would be better if you're dealing, if your business is built, if your client's business is built on the business of trading, transporting, selling, processing, storing, disposing of things that are hazardous, of things that are potentially dangerous to the environment. Do the right thing and take out the right cover. Don't rely on a poorly worded clause in a GL policy that is vague and very unsuccessful in its interpretation. I'm looking at the poll here. 5% of you have had a successful claim for cleanup under a GL policy. I mean, I'd love to poll it further around how many of you have tried to and have been unsuccessful, etc. And maybe that's a very good research point. But I just don't think that this is, you know, something that is a reliable solution to quite a complex risk. And I'll explain more in the subsequent bullet points around why this is a, you know, open to interpretation. And when you're facing a large claim, as I'm sure you're aware, as most brokers would know, you don't want to be subject to interpretations. You want to be very clear around what the coverage entails. All right. Are there any questions or comments on that point before I move on? Because I do think it is quite an important point, especially when most of your clients read this word sudden and accidental pollution and they think that they're covered. You know, the variety of responses, the lack of clarity around a period of time in your definitions and your answers, what to speak of the insurance of your clients and how they would interpret it. And I would safely assume that most of your clients reading this in a GL policy would think that they're covered for all types of pollution, not knowing the strict limitations that this phrase sudden and accidental brings about. Okay, moving on. What else about gradual pollution makes it so much more expensive? Well, there are two main factors associated with this that are really worth noting. The first one is that because gradual pollution occurs over a long period of time, it spreads. Nature works in wonderful ways, right? And the way nature works is to spread both pollutants and nutrients, to bring those to levels that are available and are manageable. So wind, sea currents, rivers, even the groundwater that is below you, depending on where you are in the country, ranges between maybe half a meter to a meter, right? If you're in the East Rand, for example, to, you know, 30, 40, sometimes 60 to 100 meters if you're on Central Joburg, depending, you know, where you are in the country. But even that groundwater is moving through porous rock at about 60 meters a year. So what is your pollution on your site now today, next year is already on your client's neighbor's site and has the probability of impacting on their boreholes, on the river, the flay, the wetland, the beach, right? Whatever it is that is going on around your client's site will now be impacted. Now, the problem with that spreading effect is obviously, one, it increases the number of claimants. And the more something spreads, the more claimants it's going to interact with. And the problem with the claimant finding out that the diesel from your underground storage tank has now impacted on their borehole is that by law, you now have to register, you have to notify the authorities. It's called a Section 30 notification under the National Environmental Management Act. And what that means is that your client has lost control over the costing, right? Government gets involved. One, they're inefficient. Two, they're very consultative. So the clock is ticking and they're bringing in many more external parties. All the claimants have a say as to how the remediation is effected, which means that your client can't take control over how they're going to fix this problem. They have to do it according to what external consultants and the regulatory authorities and the municipality, national government, etc., agree as the standard to which the remediation needs to occur. In other words, everyone needs to agree on how clean is clean, right? So you've got many claimants, and now you've got government and other stakeholders controlling the process. And the second point, Hopcroft, I guess, David. I'll come back to your question. Thank you for that. You just finish this point, if you don't mind, and I'll come back to it. So that's the first point. Lots of claimants and you lose control of the process. Second point is that spreading a pollutant from, let's say, an underground tank or from even a spilt truck that turns over and gets into the environment is that the spreading of the pollutant makes it more of a lower concentration, more dilute. And unfortunately, cleaning up pollutants from the environment at low levels of concentration is much more expensive than cleaning up pollutants when they are concentrated. Imagine I had a cup of diesel, for example, and I poured that cup of diesel into a bucket. And I said, all right, what's the cost of removing the diesel from that bucket of water? There would be some cost involved. Now you take the same cup and you pour it into your swimming pool. Of course, removing the diesel from the swimming pool will be much more expensive than removing it from the bucket because you've just got to treat so much more water, right? And that's what happens with gradual pollution. Because it's been in the environment for a long time, it spreads and it spreads and it spreads and gets more and more dilute. And the more dilute the pollutant, the more of the environment you have to treat to remove the pollutant down to acceptable levels. Okay, so those are the two main points. It spreads, it impacts on more claimants, or maybe three points. Three, you lose control of the process or your client does. And four, because of the notification to the authorities. And three, it's much more expensive to treat dilute pollutants. David Hoffman, GL doesn't actually cover first party costs, actually needs to be bought by the third party. So client has no cover for his own costs incurred to carry out the cleanup. I'm not sure, I'm not an expert on GL, just on the pollution side. Maybe somebody from I2 could could comment on that. And I'll leave Tammy and Tove to reach out. But from a EIL policy point of view, from a environmental lives point of view, in general, it needs to be triggered by a third party claim, except for the sudden and accidental claims under our EIL policy, like, for example, a trucking spill. We would respond to a first party claim, but it's on third party property. So David, I assume it's David. Let's see what, there we are, Melita's there. Thank you for responding. Melita's responded. I don't know if everybody's following the chat here, but jump onto the chat if you want to see how that discussion evolves. Thanks, Mel. All right, coupled with the fact that much of Africa's infrastructure is old, I will refer later to a due diligence to a sale between General Motors and Isuzu that we underwrote, and they had 70-year-old underground storage tanks there. We commonly see fuel retail facilities with tanks that are 40 to 50 years old. Pipelines, infrastructure, ports, harbors, there's a lot of infrastructure which hasn't been upgraded in South Africa and certainly the rest of the continent. I was at an explosives factory at the beginning of the year in a country north of us, which was 90 years old. And none of the infrastructure, the basic piping, the hard standing had been replaced in this period. Plus, and I'll be honest here, unfortunately, Africa doesn't have the best culture around maintenance. Especially under periods of economic difficulty. And we've seen this during the COVID period, is when a company is under financial distress, one of the first line items to be scrapped is maintenance. As a company is fighting for its survival, maintenance and housekeeping. You know, it's focusing on pushing out product, on trying to get revenue and trying to reduce its costs. Okay, here we have a question. I'm going to just jump in here. Reggie has asked, is the pollution on the client's premises covered under gradual pollution? Generally not, Reggie, because everybody, and that's a very good question, everybody has gradual pollution to a certain degree. You know, like the old adage says, if you want to make an omelet, you've got to break some eggs. You know, any business that is involved in any hazardous chemicals, and by hazardous chemicals, I'm also including things like milk and vegetable oil, which are very impactful on the environment if they are released in a non-compliant format. Everybody's got some degree of pollution on their site. Everything leaks sooner or later. And to this point around Africa, you know, infrastructure being old. You know, if you know, when you go to fill up your petrol or your diesel next time at your favorite filling station, just look at the brickwork around the bowsers, around the pumps, around the dispensers where you get your fuel. There will always be leaks and spills and staining, right? So it's inevitable that there will be some degree of gradual pollution on every client site that deals with hazardous chemicals. So if we were to underwrite that, unless we had a very large deductible, we would be out of business very quickly. So generally with gradual pollution, we rely on a third party trigger. And it's really and I'll show you in a subsequent slide, Reggie, how that applies. And the second large driver is the regulation. Sorry, the next large driver is the regulation. I don't know if you know this, but environmental legislation is the only, if not one of very few, aspects of law where you or your client is always guilty until proven innocent. Because science is playing catch up with nature, and legislation follows science, legislation has recognized that there are imperfections in our science, that, you know, we learn about things after they've occurred. You know, many years ago, Ronald Reagan used to be an actor, and there are, you know, videos of him in a doctor's jacket, you know, proudly stating that, you know, I forget which brand it was, Rothmans is preferred by more surgeons than any other cigarette, right? These things are going to be subject to, I believe, a lot of science. You read the disclaimers on how they test radiation of a signal from a cell phone, a non-ionic radiation that can travel up to 4 kilometers through your brain, right? And how they've, all the tests have been done, assuming that you'll be holding this a centimeter from your head, not directly on your head. We saw a large asbestosis claim in 2019 of 5 billion rand come through. You know, asbestos used to be a miracle mineral. And not so miraculous now. So gradually science is playing catch up to the detrimental effects of exposure to some of these chemicals. We used to have lead piping for water. So I think I made the point. As a result, environmental legislation is something called the precautionary principle. And it's in the preamble to our National Environmental Management Act. And I might note that South Africa's environmental legislation is some of the most stringent in the world. It was written very recently in 94, 96, that period when Pretoria was crawling with international consultants trying to advise the ANC on how to re-regulate the country. And it was very progressive and very aggressive in a people-first orientation. So in an environmental pollution type of regulation, our regulations focus on protecting human rights first as users of the environment. And as a result, this precautionary principle has come about, whereby the courts are obliged to assume that in a pollution claim, the worst case scenario is always assumed to be valid, and we start from that basis. So I'll give you several examples. In the waste legislation, all waste is assumed to be hazardous until proven otherwise. If you want to develop a new property, a new business that uses hazardous chemicals, let's say a filling station or a new factory, or a new chemical plant, you have to go through what's called an environmental impact assessment, an EIA. And many of you, I'm sure, are aware of how your clients go through this process. And the onus is on the developer, on the proponent of this new facility, to prove that the risks of their activity will not have a detrimental impact on their neighbors or the surrounding community or the groundwater or the air quality, rather than the neighbor having to prove that the activity will have a detrimental impact. In other words, the assumption is there that that industry is dirty. And the onus is on industry to prove that it's taken the necessary steps to bring its levels of risk is acceptable and not putting the surrounding community at risk. Rob Ferguson is coaching me through his question. Has anyone or any organization been taken to court, jailed, or fined under this legislation that you know? Yes, there've been many cases, not as many as I think there should have been. Recently, there was a case of a medical waste treatment company where the entire board was jailed. For all 12 people, for putting medical waste, so, you know, placentas, body parts, all the yuck that comes out of hospitals. They were putting them down old mine shafts because they just didn't have sufficient incineration capacity. So yeah, the regulators have no qualms of enacting this legislation. So the implication though in our courts is coupled with this precautionary principle. We have very strong legislation, but very weak enforcement. Unfortunately, as I'm sure you all agree, our government officials at a local government level, at an enforcement level, it's pretty erratic. And hence, to answer Rob's point, we don't see a consistency in the application of this regulations. Now, many people would say, well, you know, then that negates the need for insurance. I don't know. I would argue the other way, saying that, you know, because you're very uncertain as to what the claim might be and what the government, the courts might enforce, we think it actually supports the case for insurance because you want to eliminate that uncertainty. Investors hate uncertainty, as you know. So we think that, you know, this sort of dangerous mixture of very stringent legislation and very erratic enforcement is a bit of a toxic mix when it comes to putting your clients at risk. And we think that insurance would be an appropriate risk mitigation solution. And then just to make things worse, on top of that, we're adding fuel to fire by having a very active NGO and media. If you just, you know, Google pollution cases in South Africa, you will see it's largely driven by the NGO community, the non-governmental organizations who represent in the mainstream marginalized, poor, vulnerable community. Now, why are vulnerable communities largely the sort of, like what we saw with the asbestosis case, the bulk of the claimants, so class action, for example? Well, because the absence of enforcement of town planning has meant that informal settlements have been able to encroach and border on industrial areas. And if you look at any industrial areas in South Africa, you will see that these informal settlements creep closer and closer and closer, which means that they're getting closer and closer to being affected by any pollution. Now, in the old days, the planning was meant to be that you have an industrial area, zoned industrial area, and the residential areas were meant to be far enough away to allow a buffer because of the negative impacts of pollution. But that has changed. Now, on top of that, you've got the NGOs and media who are very happy to jump onto the bandwagon of supporting these marginalized communities. In many cases, these are valid claims, but there are certain exacerbating factors. We've got 15 minutes left. I was just getting warmed up. Okay, thanks, Nadia. That was a private message, forgive me. Anyway, so we have very active media affecting this. And then on top of that, we have foreign investors and all the banks. I don't know if you know this, but all the banks in South Africa have an internal environmental department. They all have a policy by which environmental risk needs to be screened before going to credit committee. In fact, we've developed a product to underwrite the banks because, and we'll talk about it in a minute, because all the banks are so worried about their balance sheet exposure due to environmental practices of their borrowers. So, local underwriter who understands the local conditions of your clients. And hence we place an emphasis on our risk assessments. So what is covered? If we look at a typical scenario between a first party and a third party scenario, let's say there is a release from an underground storage tank, which seeps through the groundwater into the borehole. Tom, thanks. We lost 10 minutes at the start. Yes, agreed. So I'll carry on a little bit past what's the time now? I'll carry on a little bit past 11 o'clock if that's okay with everybody. let's say it gets into the borehole and there's always a prize stud bull involved, right? Or it gets into a wetland. So what should an EIL policy typically cover? Thanks, Rihanna. It should cover the following. One, emergency response. Because yes, sudden and accidental events do occur and time is of the essence. The sooner you can intervene to limit the spread of pollutants, the better it is for everybody. First party, third party, regulator, the underwriter, etc. All right. And we give a pre-approved budget of $250,000 for our static policies and $100,000 for our mobile, for our trucking policy, for pre-approved budget for emergency response before any claim documentation has been submitted. Even if it's your local bucky brigade out in a small dorp somewhere, please get them out. Because even if they're doing their best they can, we would rather have some emergency response rather than nothing. The next one is obviously legal defense. And then here is the big, legal defense is important, obviously, because sometimes it's not clear as to where the pollution originated. There has to be a causal link between the source of pollution and the claim, right? So a physical or a chemical link, linking the claimant, a respiratory problem or a polluted borehole, that diesel in the borehole has to have come from that filling station or that factory. Now, when you're looking at industrial areas like Wadeville or, you know, Ulroad or Epping or wherever, obviously it might be difficult to identify exactly where that pollution is coming from, hence the legal defense case. So the big item here is third-party business interruption, property damage, and bodily injury. You know, people use borehole water for their potable water, for drinking, for irrigating the cattle, or it gets into the case here of a stud bull, and the farmer loses the ability to generate his revenue, or there's increased costs of working. So alternative water supplies need to be brought in to supplement the farmer's traditional supply. Then there's the cleanup itself, right? Now we believe that it's appropriate to clean up the entire pollution pathway all the way to the source. We don't replace the tank itself. We don't, as the EIL policy, cover the assets claim of, you know, betterment, repairs, upgrades to the tank itself. But what we do is clean up along the pollution pathway all the way from the third party claimants all the way to the source of pollution, even on the first property site. And then we cover something called ecological restoration, which, you know, basically means that if your pollution gets into a wetland, a flay, or a river, it's one thing removing the pollutant from that flay, but now you're left with a clean but a sterile flay, right? It's lost its topsoil if you scraped it all out or you pumped out the water, which doesn't really help the bugs and the bees and the birds dependent on that flay or wetland. That's when we bring in the hippies with their seeds and their manure and their compost and their chochos and bugs and repopulate that wetland or that flay or that river or that beach or whatever back to its prior ecological function. And then lastly, I mentioned earlier that, you know, in the event of a pollution event, one has to register a Section 30 notification under the National Environmental Management Act, which means that there's an ongoing commitment around reporting, monitoring, evaluation to the authorities as well as other stakeholders. But even for a sudden and accidental event, I'm sure you can cast your mind back to carte blanche, you know, many stories regarding noodles in the Durban Harbor or the doozy being polluted by a release due to a tank failure from just outside Maritzburg, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So we've decided to cover the ongoing monitoring, reporting, public relations and crisis communications and regulatory liaison, which we believe your clients would need when responding to press, media, governmental inquiries as well. We can also cover a landlord, if they need protection against potential pollution events from a tenant who might impact their common property or the value of their land holding against claims from neighbors or other tenants, or the insured could be the tenant themselves who needs to protect themselves against a claim, not only from third parties, but also from landlords as well as other tenants. So if you've got any clients falling into that category, please give us a call. So this is the range of the products that we have at the moment. Our truck safe product is a genuine sudden and accidental response case, which responds to obviously a truck, you know, trucks rolling along the freeway very happily. I'm sure you've all seen that video of the driver having his, you know, going to collect his cell phone at the back of the cabbie, right? And then you gradually see the truck just roll off the freeway. What we found is that 80% of 80% of road accidents are due to driver behavior. And hence in our rating module, for those of you that need to get off at 11, I just want to stress this particular point. We can offer up to a 70% discount on our premiums if your trucking clients tell us how they're looking after the welfare of their drivers, in particular, how they're managing their drivers' health. You know, have they, do they suffer from sleep apnea? Do they have their HIV under control? You know, wellness days, VCT, ARV programs, driver turnover, driver training, etc. Driver. So we place a lot of emphasis in rewarding correct behavior. So our proposal forms, I know, are quite involved. They ask a lot of questions around all of these risk mitigatory effects. In fact, I'm going to jump to a screen here. These are the questions that we ask. This is a direct screenshot from our rating module. And you can see all the questions that we ask around driver route planning, driver fatigue management, driver training, driver turnover, driver wellness, HIV programs. And if you, your clients could just, or we can even help them. We can have a, we can call your client with you obviously on the phone as the broker, and we can talk them through some of these issues. Because we suspect that there are many businesses out there who are doing the right thing, but are not getting appropriate reductions in their premiums. And we're, you know, we're really receptive to rewarding them for doing the right thing. Our TankSafe product is for our vanilla static products that cover things like filling stations, factories, warehouses, depots, etc. Ian, I see there's a question here. In most cases, petrol stations operated by an individual, but the property belongs to an oil company. Who's the responsible party? Thank you so much, Ian, for reminding me on that. If I could come back to this slide, because it is an important point that I missed. In terms of our legislation, Section 28 of the National Environmental Management Act and Section 19 of the National Water Act says that anybody who owns, controls, or manages any activity which causes pollution, or anybody that benefits from any activity which causes pollution, has what's called a duty of care to do three things. One, to prevent pollution from occurring or spreading. Two, to compensate affected third parties. And three, to clean up any acts which caused pollution. So if you look at this, anybody who owns, controls, manages, or anybody that benefits from any act which causes pollution, the last one, benefit, means any shareholders, stake, you know, any investors. We had a claim recently, there was a court case brought against the mining company, which had 40 respondents. It was brought against this gold mining company by an NGO. The first respondent was the operating entity. Then the three joint respondents were the other shareholders. And then the other 36 respondents were all the banks, right? So the legislation is extremely broad. So looking at that definition, definitely any contractors, any agents, any under your branded marketer scenario, Ian, where the oil company might only own the tank, or they might only own the fuel in the tank, and they have an independent operator, agent, contractor, partner, branded marketer running the filling station. All the parties are jointly and severally liable. And by the way, pollution liability is a criminal liability. So it's pretty serious and very far-reaching. Just to wrap up the list of our products in the couple of minutes left, SiteSafe is our bespoke facility for more complex facilities such as airports, chemical plants, refineries, hazardous waste landfills, etc., where, you know, TankSafe is our more vanilla one. Our proposal forms, for example, only relate to the first two. If you want to talk to any of these other products, please, that involves more of a discussion. It's not something that's easily managed through a standard proposal form. PropSafe covers the, thanks guys for those that need to go, enjoy your questions and comments, thank you. So PropSafe covers the transfer of potentially contaminated property. So if any of your clients are in the business of buying or selling industrial property, please give me a call. It's, you know, depending on whether they're the buyer or the seller, we can structure a product, a multi-year product, to protect the selling price or offer warranties and indemnities. I'll just talk briefly around the recent example of when General Motors sold to Isuzu. There was a 70-year-old engine manufacturing plant down in Struendale, just outside Port Elizabeth. And, you know, they had these very old tanks and there was existing known pollution on site. But nobody was really sure how far it had spread, if once the deal had been done, whose liability was accruing to the seller or the buyer, and a new risk assessment to be done would have taken 6 months and cost between 5 to 10 million rand. And they needed the deal to be done very quickly. And within a week, we had written our policy into the sale and purchase agreement in lieu of a warranty and indemnity. It was taken out by the seller, ceded to the buyer. It was a 3-year policy because based on the mobility of pollutants and the geology and the soil at the time, we believed that any claims during a 3-year period would have been due to pollution caused by the seller. And after that, due to pollution caused by the buyer. And within a week, we had it resolved. Everybody thought it was very fair. It preserved the purchase price, gave the buyer their security that they needed, and everybody moved on. And I think it's a great example of how insurance does facilitate business rather than just being an overhead for a rainy day. Our BankSafe product, we've mentioned, the banks are looking at this very closely, especially in light of a post-COVID scenario where the bank defaults have increased by over 80%. So commercial loan books by South African banks has traditionally been only around 0.5%. We've seen this increase to about 0.8, 0.9% now as businesses struggle under a COVID scenario. And as I mentioned, the majority of businesses going through financial duress compromise on their housekeeping and their maintenance, resulting in a greater risk of pollution occurring on their first property premises. And we are working with the banks to see how we can protect that loan book. So if any of you have any banks or lenders or providers of credit, even trade finance, construction guarantees, etc., please talk to me around how we could design a product or a solution for your risks. And then MindSafe. For those of you that have mining clients, please give me a call. We can even underwrite coal. I know all the large reinsurers around the world are excluding coal due to climate change risks. But we still rely on coal mining in this country. And we've all benefited from coal mining. Even as I speak, these electrons coming from my light bulb and driving this laptop are all, you know, 85% of those are coming from coal-fired power stations. And you know, so coal mining is going to be with us for a long time in this country, and we think that they need support in being able to manage their mines responsibly and close them responsibly. So any type of mining, tailings dams included, evaporation ponds, leachate ponds, etc., return water dams, we can look at, no problems there. In terms of our quota share treaty, we can write on our treaty up to 65 million on an each and every basis, and our annual aggregate goes up to as high as 175 million. Barry Stark, considering the gradual spread of groundwater pollution, is the EIL policy on an occurrence basis? Thank you very much, Barry, I missed that point. No, this is a claims made basis policy. So there's no retroactive date in our covers if the gradual pollution solution is purchased. So the pollution could have started when Jan van Riebeeck arrived in South Africa, and we would cover it. Hence, it places a lot of emphasis on our risk assessment capabilities for us to be able to properly survey the property beforehand. We generally do that at our cost and is built into the cost of the premium. We have a process by which if our indicative non-binding quote done at a desktop level is accepted, and then we go out and we incur, you know, 100,000, 200,000 rands worth of risk assessment costs to confirm on site which was stated on a desktop basis, and then our policy is rejected, then we work with you, the brokers, to get a fair sharing of the risk costs in advance. And if you want details on that, please let me know, because the risk assessment process for gradual pollution is obviously critical. We need to satisfy ourselves as the underwriter that we have a reasonable view of the probability of gradual pollution being present on site. But if we're satisfied with that risk, and to date we haven't rejected, we haven't declined any gradual pollution risks, there's been a handful, very, very few, like, you know, 50-year-old filling stations where literally the tank is sitting in its own product. But those tend to be more extreme examples. You know, generally, we are quite happy to look at the risk. So there's no retroactive date, and hence it's a claims-made basis policy. As long as the claim or a notification of a potential claim occurs within the insurance period and the premium is paid up and everything's in order, that claim will be respected. Okay. So this is examples of some types of premiums. So for a factory having chemical storage above, below ground, or an effluent plant treatment or a waste storage area, the premium is not as expensive as people commonly think. For a 5 million rand limit on an each and every basis, you can be looking at a premium of somewhere between 10 to 30,000 rand an annum. So that's, you know, less than 1,000 rand a month. For a fuel retail facility, for example, covering fire, water runoff, surface accident with large release, underground tank leak, or a tank replacement where they pull up the tank and they see that there's a pool of pollution below the tank. That's pretty common. You know, again, for a limit of 5 million, somewhere between 12 and 90,000. Now you might say, well, that's a huge spread in terms of the premium. It's highly sensitive to the age of the tanks. For tanks for 8 years or less in age, we're looking at about 1,000 rand a month to cover the whole filling station, not just per tank. Whereas for tanks that are 40 years or more, you're looking at a premium that is, you know, 8 times higher. Tom has asked, for enviro spills, what is the period limit for future claims that does not come to the fore immediately within weeks? So we've extended that to a 3-year period, Tom. So post the notification of a potential claim within the insurance period, the client has up to 3 years to, you know, do what it needs to do to finalize the claim. Does that answer the question? Let me know if it doesn't. Okay, moving on, I just also wanted to share with you how the limits work. You might have a site where there's more than one pollution event. In this particular example, this filling station has a surface water event. That event itself is subject to the each and every limit, right? Another pollution event would be having to have its own limit. So let's say there's a 5 million rand limit with multiple claims. That pollution event is subject to that each and every limit. This would also be subject to a 5 million rand limit. Of course, if the annual aggregate was also five million, then both of these claims would need to come in within that limit to be fully covered. Hence, we encourage brokers to please consider an annual aggregate higher than the each and every limit in order to ensure automatic reinstatement. One, of course, can buy more cover post a claim to cover a potential second event. This is also important for companies with more than one site to ensure that there is sufficient capacity for multiple events within the same company that has more than one site. Okay. So as I said, we reward clients for doing the right thing. We can offer up to a 70% reduction in premium when our risk assessment questions are fully answered. And I've given you an example. This is an example in the trucking business. A fuel tanker with no a fuel tanker in transport carrying hazardous goods where we don't get any information. There's no risk management protocols that have been reported to us. A 1 million rand limit of indemnity. You're looking at 1,300 rand a month. However, if they do tell us how they're managing driver fatigue and HIV and all the other things I referred to previously, that comes right down to about 360 rand a month. All right. We don't charge for our call center. We cover the third party bodily injury property damage as previously stated. We, unlike other players in the market, have a panel of cleanup contractors. We think it's important to support the market and to provide local response teams who are closest to the spill or response teams that have this right equipment. So we have about 12 different cleanup contractors on our panel. We audit them every 2 years for suitability of location, equipment, the size, the maintenance, the training, et cetera, making sure that you have a wide variety of adequate capacity at the best possible rates and the most suitable response potential to any incident. We have an internal dedicated loss adjuster working with us on an SLA who is responsible for keeping our claims costs contained. Obviously, the better our loss ratios, the more benefit we can pass on in terms of reduced premiums. And he is, and his team is also responsible for project managing the claims and liaising with the regulatory authorities. Tom, I've addressed this, so we don't have any retroactive date. It's a claims made basis policy. I mentioned the pre-approved budgets for emergency response. Our Sasria type cover for non-political riot and strike is up to 1 million rand. So we saw, especially during the COVID period, or just before earlier in the year, there was a lot of tax on trucks with drivers who, you know, came from Zimbabwe or Malawi or Mozambique. That type of, those types of attacks on those vehicles where the vehicles were set on fire and pollution resulting from those types of attacks would have been covered up to 1 million rand limit. We have recently finalized the wording with our reinsurers to cover bulk product tank contamination. So if a truck deposits diesel into a petrol underground storage tank or diesel into petrol, we can cover up to 750,000 rand on the decontamination of that tank and the loss of the product there. We mentioned the risk assessments done at our cost, and you know, we understand that this is a new product and oftentimes it's difficult for brokers to properly advise their clients as to the appropriate limits of indemnity. We use a triangulation method to arrive at our estimated probable loss and maximum loss. And we're happy to share that information with you as the broker so that you can correctly advise your clients on the appropriate covers that they need to take out. Just to clarify with you that the methods that we use are a combination of market research in terms of other products elsewhere in the world, working very closely with our reinsurers to understand what premiums and claims they've seen on similar incidents elsewhere, but also to look at from an empiric basis. We work with very sort of ground up data. So we look at surrounding property values. We look at average household earnings in the communities that might be affected. We look at depth to groundwater. We look at the geology, which might affect the mobility of pollutants. We look at the topography, so how steep the slope is, how rapidly a pollutant might move off-site. And we put all of these into our calculations to simulate possible scenarios to calculate our EPLs and EMLs, which is obviously quite closely linked to the types of limits that you might wish to advise your clients. On our trucking product, we don't have any deductible, nor do we offer an excess buy down. We offer a side tank option for non-hazardous loads. So thanks, Tom. Appreciate the feedback. Much appreciated. So if you have a trucking client, who's carrying, furniture or paper or empty bottles or whatever it is, might not be a hazardous load. You think that they don't need an environmental product for their fleet. Bear in mind, please, that they are carrying up to 2,500 liters of diesel in their side tank, which is the fuel tank for the horses itself in an articulated truck. So we can offer you very competitive, 20, 30 Rand a month per vehicle to cover the incident where there might be in an accident and that volume of diesel is released into the environment. We've had claims just from a side tank cover as high as 130,000 Rand for just the side tank. But if you are taking out hazardous loads cover, the trucking company is transporting fuel or chemicals, etc., then we don't charge for the side tank cover on the hazardous loads. We offer driver death or disability. That's been raised up to 30,000 Rand. Loading, offloading is covered, plus heating or mixing, such as cement trucks or bitumen, etc. Ian, are sites certified after cleanup by government? Well, they should be. The National Waste Act talks around the decontamination of sites and a national site contamination register. Of course, what's there in theory and legislation might not translate into practice. What the government is pretty good at is certifying the methodology for the cleanup. And we will not. So generally in a cleanup, there's two stages. There's the emergency response and then there's the actual remediation. Emergency response can happen in a couple of hours, a couple of days to contain, prevent the pollution from spreading any further. And then the long work of the remediation and the cleanup takes place. And that could last for several years, months generally, weeks certainly. Before we start phase two, we get clarity from the authorities as to what methods of remediation will be acceptable. So in situ, bioremediation, pick up, load, truck it off to the nearest landfill, et cetera, et cetera. That we reach agreement with the authorities on. Whether or not they're certified at the end, we wait and we hope, but certainly that confirmation is there from the outset. Temporary storage for trucking. Cheers, Casabal. Ian, let me know if you've got further questions on that. Temporary storage up to 3 days is covered. During COVID, we extended it up to 30 days. So talk to us if there's any particular scenarios there that you're envisaging. And then emergency medical expenses to a third party limited to 15,000. The one scenario that we did hear of is a chemical truck was driving down the M3 carrying acid, and it had a small leak in its valve at the back that was releasing a fine spray of chemicals. And it was overtaken by a pedestrian vehicle that had its passenger window open. And this fine acid mist went into the window and obviously gave a chemical burn to the passenger in the vehicle overtaking it. So, you know, one might be surprised as to the variety of events that can result. Ian, future claims, it's a good point. I would suggest that the insurer there keeps their policies enforced. Yes, please engage. Chris, please engage with Chrisanne. I'm getting the proposal forms. Tove, please can we check that our proposal forms are on the website? They should be, certainly for our truck safe and our tank safe. And then the remainder talks to bank safe and mine safe that we might need a separate session on. So I'm going to skip that, because I think that that is enough for one day and we are up on time. Thank you very much for your time, everybody. I know it was very rushed. Yes, Fiona, you can also get the proposal forms from your broker consultant. Thank you, Claire. Thank you, everybody, for your time. I'm sorry it was so rushed. If you want more detailed training, please let Tove know. Cheers, Noreen. Cheers, Riet. Dankie baie. Lekker dag verder. All right. Tot ziens, jullie.